Hello, everyone. For those who don't know me, my name is Nina Boeger, and I'm a senior lecturer here at the Law School. I'm also the director of our Centre for Law and Enterprise. And it gives me great pleasure to welcome you here in the Law School. What brings us together here today, I think, is a common interest in preserving aspects of social fairness, solidarity, and sustainability in today's corporate capitalism. We may call it responsible capitalism, or social enterprise, or the social responsibility of business. And we all approach that responsibility in different roles, as entrepreneurs, as politicians, as civil servants, teachers, students, activists or lawyers, and so on. We are united, I think, in our concern to push the boundaries of capitalism and the business operating within its frame in the direction of a socially just and responsible form. So, since 2005, social businesses in the UK have been able to choose the legal form of the Community Interest Company, or CIC, as a vehicle for their efforts and their enterprises. It's fair to say that there have been wonderful successes as a result of the CIC format, and these were watched with a keen eye from many places around the world. But since 2005, we've also seen the challenges for social enterprises grow around the world. So the aim of our event today is to reflect on the successes of the CIC format, to identify challenges, and more than anything, to focus on taking things forward. For us in the Law School, as in other places around the university, a particular challenge is to make our research and facilities available to social enterprises and community businesses in those areas where they're most needed. And this event is part of that larger project for us. To give you just a quick briefing on the plenary, we've got some brilliant speakers here today, which I am very, very pleased about. So I'm going to introduce you very briefly to our speakers before I pass on the baton, as it were. George Ferguson, the mayor of Bristol, who will open the plenary. And then we have Professor Wendy Larner, the dean of our Faculty of Social Sciences and Law. We have Sara Burgess, the regulator for community interest companies. We have Dave Hunter from Bates Braithwaite, a fantastic law firm who's been very involved with community interest companies. And we have Carl Belizaire, the director of Social Enterprise Works, an institution that really heavily supports social enterprises in and around Bristol. And finally, we have Paula Woodman, who is from the British Council and specializes there again in support for social enterprises, including community interest companies. So I'm going to ask people to speak in pairs, in a sense. So I'm going to allow for two presentations and then take questions from the ground. That's what I was planning on doing. Without further ado, then, I'll pass the microphone over to George Ferguson, the Mayor of Bristol.
So, thank you very much, Nina, and thank you for hosting this 10th anniversary event of Community Interest Companies, CICs. And it's great to have Sara Burgess here, and see you again, Sara. You've done so much for this whole movement over the last 8 years, and really, really appreciate it. And thank you, Wendy, for hosting us, and the Centre for Law and Enterprise. This is a huge celebration, I think. It's something that's very close to my heart. I was director of one of the early Bristol CICs, the Pierian Centre, and it's great to see June Burrows here, who you'll hear from later. I think that CIC was a very successful one, that had a period of time that it did great things in. And we now should celebrate the fact that that was one of the small sparks that has led Bristol to being a city of social enterprise, and with now 250 CICs, but many, many social enterprises beyond that. And my life has, in a way, been involved with social and cultural enterprise, and is always difficult to define. It's that area that somehow lies between hard business and soft charity, and it is about doing good through business, and is often more effective for being so. And some of you will know that, those of you are in Bristol, that I live in an old tobacco factory that was part of Bristol's thriving industry that killed a lot of people but built the university. And so, well, was that a social enterprise? I don't think so, really, but it was certainly about benefaction. And social enterprise isn't about benefaction. It is about being effective through the work we do. And I like to feel that the tobacco factory is part of that movement. As a result of that, I was led into partnership in various other things across the city, that including Hamilton House, which some of you are probably based in, that is serving that whole movement of social enterprise. What I really welcome about social enterprise and community interest companies is the variety and the extra vitality they bring to the city. They bring a different way of doing things. And I think if anything defines Bristol is that we like to do things differently. And I think CICs in Bristol certainly contribute to that, and have become a really important part of our culture and well-being. And have encouraged startups, have created jobs, have provided many social benefits alongside what's being done. And so while there is a legal structure to CICs, and I think that is a vitally important part of it, it is a legal structure with a light touch that encourages people to be able to be a bit freer in the way they do business than if they were tied down by all the bureaucracy that is sometimes perceived to come with fully blown companies and with charities. They cover so many different aspects in this city alone of art and the arts, of sport, of education, of health, media even, festivals, and certainly in the environmental field, which is so important to Bristol as European Green Capital this year, are playing a huge part. And some of them are involved in the Green Capital Partnership, which is a partnership of 800 organisations, including this university, that is the reason, basically, why we became European Green Capital and will be the legacy of European Green Capital and be able to carry on with that work that we can't all do through corporate means and are vitally important. I'm paid with Bristol Pounds. Bristol Pound is a CIC. It therefore touches on hundreds of businesses across the city. So there are many, many businesses that are engaging with CICs if they're not CICs themselves. The Bristol Health Partnership is a CIC. There are so many health and wellbeing organisations, I'm co-chair of the Bristol Health and Wellbeing Board, that are engaging with CICs. And if you use Social Enterprise Works, you are engaging with a CIC, and Social Enterprise Works has given birth to many startups and CICs themselves. And if you're a student of the School of Social Entrepreneurs, of course, you're then engaging with another CIC and possibly becoming one as a result of it. I'm sorry I'm not going to be here the whole of the rest of the day, because I look at the panels and I can see a huge amount of expertise and experience, and I want us to benefit from that as a city. I think that leadership is about enabling rather than just doing, that some tough decisions have to be made, and I'm of course to blame for everything that everybody does, but I take that on the chin. But what I think is the strength of this city is that there are so many individuals, independent people who are doing great things and have built great organisations. You know, Sustrans that has built thousands of miles of cycleways across the UK started as an individual who inspired some of us to get involved and started with it in a small way and have made a huge impact nationally on our transport and health. That, I believe, we probably would have been a CIC if it had started in the 70s and early 80s. So I'm hoping that some really good stories, experiences, and challenges, as you said, Nina, will come out of this gathering, and I look forward to the feedback, and thank you very much for making this what's going to be a really worthwhile day. Thank you.
So again, I'd like to add my thanks to those of George, to Nina, for inviting me to speak to you in my role as Dean of the Faculty of Social Sciences and Law here at the University of Bristol. So it is in part my job to welcome you to the university today, to the law school today, but also to underline, those of you who are Bristol-based may have noticed that in the last while, the University of Bristol, not before time, some might say, has really discovered that it is not just in this fantastic city, but it is indeed of this fantastic city. So one of the great delights of my now 11 years in Bristol, I know my Bristolian accent still needs a bit of work, but 11 years in Bristol, is seeing how this has given rise to new bilateral relationships that for us at the university have been extraordinarily rewarding. They really have enriched our research and educational endeavours, and indeed the endeavours of our city partners. Now, Nina invited me to speak as Dean, but like George, I also have a deep personal commitment to CICS. One of the arenas in which my research work sits is precisely this question about social enterprise and the work that social enterprise models do. So just to give you a little bit of context, over the last now 7 years, I've been working with Jamie Pike of Coexist in Hamilton House, doing a range of different things. Initially, finding a researcher to work with Coexist to document the activity as Hamilton House began to fill up. Then co-designing a graduate course that got students engaged in questions that Coexist thought were important to them and their activities, that allowed both the students and the organisation to be reflexive about their practice, about the new political and economic forms that they were working on. And then most recently, as researcher and community organisation, we are part of a much larger research programme led by Professor McDermott here in the law school that asks the question, how might it be that we can co-produce new forms of regulation that engage and support communities at the margins, however the margins get defined, And integral to that is a co-supervised PhD student who spends 3 years working within Coexist to, again, ask questions of relevance to both academic debates and practitioner debates. So as I said, this is a kind of activity that's very close to my heart. Now, if you look around the University of Bristol, you'll find many researchers, a surprising number of researchers, involved in these kinds of activities. But until recently, I think my story, like many others of these stories, the motivation for doing this was outside of our day jobs. Now, the really important shift that has happened in recent years is that more and more researchers and educators are doing this kind of engaged work, not in spite of their day jobs, but actually as a much more integral part of our endeavours. So what that means is that increasingly there is both institutional support and indeed the incentives for closer collaboration and engagement between academics, researchers, educators, and partners, including social enterprises. Now, just to give you a sense of what that looks like in the context of this university, and it won't be atypical, other universities, most notably UWE in this city, but indeed universities both nationally and internationally, are now entering into this new terrain with a gusto, I think it's fair to say. So let me just touch on some of our more recent activities, and I'm going to ask people to do a little bit of hand waving so you don't think I'm taking credit for other people's work. So Julie Allison at the front here. So Julie's our social entrepreneur in residence. So we've long had entrepreneurial activity within the university, but historically it's been much more aligned to the STEM areas, science, technology, engineering, medicine. What we're now seeing is this activity spilling over across the university, and Julie is leading that for us and has more recently launched an initiative that I'm sure she's going to talk about later on called the Good Lab Initiative that links up with other universities to provide incubation support for social enterprises. So this is a really nice example of that institutional support that I was nodding towards previously. More generally, in the area of impact, where universities are being asked to very explicitly document what it is that they are doing to ensure that their research reaches wider end users, is the language, but reaches wider constituencies. What we see are initiatives like the ESRC-funded Impact Acceleration Account. So what this means is that researchers are being asked to think much more self-consciously about how their research might make a difference in the wider world. Now, I think as a social scientist, and I think I can speak for my law colleagues in this regard as well, this is a fantastic opportunity for us. We've always wanted to change the world, and now we've got the best excuse in the world to actually think much more carefully about how we might do that. Now we've really got our opportunity. So again, just to give you an example of some of the work that we're trying to support through this Impact Acceleration Account, Carolyn Bird, who I know is here, another hand waving, is working with Gary Topp, hand waving here, to try and build new relationships through the Bristol Green Capital Partnership that George was mentioning earlier, by thinking about, again, how we might strengthen relationships and what it is that we might build off the back of stronger relationships between the university and community organisations. Not, I hasten to add, academics doing research on partner organisations, but very seriously asking that question, how is it we might co-produce and co-design both the research questions that we think are important and the kinds of projects that we might then build off the back of those questions. Now, if you're trying to deliver on ambitions to change the world, the question of those who hold power, politicians and policymakers, comes up fairly quickly. So again, one of the things that we've done in recent years, you've all got your Policy Bristol folders in front of you. So Policy Bristol, very ably led by Deborah Wilson, who I don't think is in the room, is our institutional mechanism for, again, building those stronger relationships between the academic work that we do and those in the corridors of power, whether that be Whitehall or Brussels, or indeed just down the bottom of the hill in terms of Park Street. So building on much longer standing efforts to engage widely, led by our Centre for Public Engagement, who've long been having more collaborative conversations in the city, but again, very explicitly asking that question, how do we ensure that our research addresses the questions that are of burning importance in the current era, and that the research itself is working for those who really want to make a difference. We're also very proud of the work of our colleague Kerry Facer, who is one of the two AHRC Connected Community Leadership Fellows. So what Kerry's work does is ask very hard questions about the purpose and value of co-produced research. So how is it, many of you may well be familiar with the wider Connected Communities Research Programme running through Research Councils UK at the moment, how is it that this co-produced moment can really add value for both academics and community organisations? And then last but by no means least, because it's what has brought us here today, is the really important work that is now being delivered within this law school. So this new Centre for Law and Enterprise that Nina has been getting off the ground in the last year or so is a really exciting initiative. And I think this conference today is a forerunner for what I think will be very, very important developments in this regard. Those of us who aren't lawyers tend to think about things like regulation and governance and as sort of boring things that sit in the background. But actually, once you foreground them, that question about what forms do we need to facilitate what kinds of activity is absolutely crucial. And Nina is leading that discussion in this university, and I really want to commend her for that. Our law clinic, which again, historically has tended to do what law clinics do in terms of working around social issues, more traditionally defined, is beginning to think about how it could scale up its activities to develop a strategy whereby the law clinic is working with students and working with social enterprises in the city to offer legal support for social enterprises. Again, an agenda setting an initiative, and I am hugely proud that this university is asking that question and beginning to do that kind of work. And what this does is build on a base of work within this law school. Morag McDermott, I mentioned earlier, who's been working with the Citizens Advice Bureau and advice agencies. Bronwyn Morgan, who's been working on the sharing economy more widely. But in a city like Bristol, having a law school that is asking really important questions about the nature of social enterprise and how better to support social enterprise is just fantastic. And I think I'll just stop there.
Any questions that Wendy or George have left unanswered, we are such as to ask them, so please can I invite anybody who's got questions in response to those three presentations. Think about it, yeah. Yes, please.
Thank you. I've got a question. Is there any research or evidence that shows that the community interest companies that have adopted that model could not have existed without that legal reform, or that they have a specific advantage that they wouldn't have felt made it possible to operate if they had taken another form.
Might supplement that, I don't know. I was involved in discussions right at the beginning of community interest companies, but the PCI documents then was, one of the reasons for setting them up, the idea of it, was to make it possible to be investors in a social enterprise. So a kind of a mezzanine kind of investment, or medium scale, you know, not fully commercial, but social purpose, and to drive the impact agenda. I think it's interesting, as George was saying, there's a lot of social enterprises in Bristol, some are CIC, some are not. Picking up on what Mark's saying, it would be interesting to know, and I don't know whether that research is done, how much of the social enterprises are actually investment friendly rather than more entrepreneurially structured as community bodies, if you see what I mean. And is that maybe, testing that out, maybe an interesting next steps.
Can I apply to the whole panel, because I know there will be views. It sounds like it's a piece of research there for you to work with. We don't necessarily have that information. The CIC model isn't for everybody. It isn't designed to be for everybody. So it's for those entrepreneurs who want to take on their social responsibility and to demonstrate it through using the structure and by having some oversight on what they're doing. So there's a particular reason that CICs go down this route, and they don't have to do it, they can be an ordinary social enterprise. If they are an ordinary social enterprise, that can be changed relatively easily. It's not that simple, but it can happen, whereas the CIC can't. So there is something about continuity, and we are seeing that with community interest companies, in that they are surviving, they are lasting, and that they are actually moving forward with what they've decided to do. I was in Cambridge on Tuesday, where they launched an interim report on a piece of research on innovative CICs and how they tackle innovation, and that might give you some indication of how things are working, and give you maybe some answers to your question. That piece of research, I think, is going to be available later on in the year. They're just about to do the final bit of survey, and then they're going to put it all together. But it was certainly very interesting hearing the statistics that they produced. So while I can't give you a figures answer, CICs are being successful with what they do and when they take on the model, and the numbers are growing.
One more question before we move on to the next set of speakers. Right, let's move on.
We're off the hook.
Yeah, but did you want to come in?
Can I invite, given that we've just heard from you anyway, can I invite Sara Burgess, then, the current regulator for community interest companies? Thank you.
Thank you, Nina. I could talk about CICs all day, so you're probably just going to have to shut me up at some point. But what I want to talk to you is a bit about what's happened over the last 10 years and the way things have gone with community interest companies, and there's some very exciting things that have been happening. If you want a good example of collaboration, what is happening here today is really it. When I first started to think about having a series of roadshows to celebrate the 10th anniversary of CICs, I came to Bristol and talked to June Burrough, because I knew she was the person who would be able to put me in the right direction and get me the connections I needed. And I was envisaging that it would be a small social event where we would just say, well done CICs, what a fantastic thing, and have a cup of tea and go home. We then met Nina and Julie, who had a much bigger idea, and the result is this, and it's down to them and down to Nina and her hard work in pulling this together. A whole day's event where we're able to look at CICs and social enterprise and share our thinking. And that's what I really wanted from these events. I wanted you as CICs to be able to get together and meet each other and talk and share what you're doing and share your ideas. That's really what CICs are about. CICs share. And it's really great. So thank you. Thank you, George, for being here. I'm very honoured that you were willing to come and find the time to come and talk to us. Thank you, Nina. Thank you, Julie. Thank you, June. Thank you, Dave, who's there. That was the team who pulled this together, but Nina was the one who coordinated it. And thank you, Wendy, for allowing us to be here, because this is amazing. It's the second time this week I've stood in the lecture theatre of a prominent university to talk with CICs. I never imagined many, many years ago when I left school that I would be doing something like this, and it's a real privilege to stand here in a really prominent university and be talking. It's going on my CV because, as Nina rightly says, I'm coming to the end of my term of office as Community Interest Company Regulator. I've been here for 8 years. I will finish exactly on the dot of 8 years on the 13th of September, which is a Sunday, so that won't actually be my last working day, but it will be my last day for being paid. And it has been amazing. My predecessor set up the protocols and the policies and the office base, which gave me a real good platform to come in and do what I've done working with CICs, working with other organisations, and to actually be in a very privileged position, actually, of seeing this model grow and develop out of the work that you're doing. Going around the country at these roadshows, I'm listening to CICs telling their stories. And they are all amazing, interesting stories. And the research on innovation in CICs is reflecting that. You are passionate, you're determined, you're motivated. You're being a CIC because that's what you want to be, and that's the statement you want to give, and that's what you want to say. And you're facing huge challenges by doing that. Facing huge challenges as small businesses, facing huge challenges as large businesses. But you're doing it, and you're doing it with a model that, well, I'm biased, I think is great, that I think gives you competitive advantage because you are making a very clear statement about what it is you're doing to your stakeholders, to your funders, to your financiers, to people who want to know that their investment, whether it's time or money or in using your services, is actually being used in a proper way and that there is some oversight to it. So I think it gives you a real advantage. But it's not the only model. It's not the only option for you. It is chosen for a particular reason, and it depends what a social entrepreneur wants from their business and wants for the future of their business. Once a CIC, always a CIC. You're not ever going to stop being a CIC unless you wind your company up or unless you convert it to a charity. You're probably not going to convert it to a charity because you've gone down that route in the first instance before you decided to be a CIC. That wasn't the case in the early days, and we did have some organisations that did move into the world of charities, and that was more appropriate for them. These days, people think much more carefully and do their comparisons much more carefully, and the business advisors understand better what it is that we're talking about with CIC, that we're talking about business, that we're talking about commercial, that we're talking about profit. It's the way we use profit that's important. The government at a meeting of the G8 last year, I think it was, Dan will probably tell me it was the year before, but anyway, fairly recently, talked about profit for purpose. I can't think of any better way of describing community interest companies than organisations that use their profit for purpose. You use it for a social purpose, and you have identified a unique need for the service that you deliver. We have over 11,200 community interest companies now registered. We registered 390 last month. That was a huge number. We've never registered that many CICs before. 390. 80 odd of those were solar energy companies, I have to say. Solar, are there any solar energy companies represented here today? Okay, right. All right. This has come from an initiative from DEC, who are recommending that CICs be set up in partnership, I suppose, in many cases, with large energy companies, your EDFs, your SSEs, all those energy companies. And it's working to set up solar farms in areas that then feed back into the national grid, and the community interest company then benefits from what gets fed back to them. It's huge potential, it's great potential, but I do have some fears about where the community interest will be with those organisations and where the money will actually go with those organisations. So I have allowed them to register because there was a deadline for them to get a double feed-in tariff if they set up these kind of companies. I have allowed them to register with reservation, and that's the advantage of being a regulator, because I can do that. I have made them answer some very difficult questions and prove who they are, because actually they were just registering as CICs and not telling me what was behind, what was going on, and I knew what was behind it. I have also written to all the directors of those companies and told them that they need to remember that they are directors of community interest companies, that they have a responsibility as directors of community interest companies, and we will be monitoring their progress. It has huge potential. It could be fabulous, and it could be a problem. I'm working with DEC, I'm working with Treasury to make sure that it's not, because that's a lot of very high-profile businesses that could make a huge difference to the reputation of CICs for the good if it works the way it should. There's been a huge change in the landscape for CICs over the 10 years. When I first started, there weren't even 1,000 CICs, and they were all very small businesses, apart from one. But they were small, one- and two-man bands, local organisations. Nobody really knew what they were or what they were for or what they could do. So, I mean, I used to talk about the Totnes Rickshaw Company as a good example of CICs, and you can imagine that's very small. It's a little rickshaw that gets people into Totnes up a hill, I think, which I think is probably quite difficult. But they were, you know, they were a real example of community interest. They had a real benefit. We've gone from that sort of company, and we still have them. Those companies are still here. They're still operating, to something like the health organisations, and we've got the Bristol one represented here. 90% of the social enterprise spin-outs from health 18 months ago became community interest companies. Contrary to popular understanding, they're not private companies. They're private in the sense that they're fully registered companies, but they're community interest companies with an asset lock. And a lot of them are doing really well, and they're doing some amazing social enterprise stuff, which is really good to see, because they can and they couldn't before. So they get their funding for their commission services, and they do the GP services, and they do the mental health services, and they do the community services, and then they do things on top of that. And they are embracing social enterprise. They're on a huge learning curve, but they're all, I think all of them, are share companies, and their shareholders are the people who work for them. So they have a real input into how they deliver their services. That's how it's changed. We never thought, when CICs were set up 10 years ago, that that's where we would be today. Nobody ever imagined that CICs would be running big public services. And they're going to be doing more of that. The solar energy is an example of where it's got to. We started with small uncertain steps, and we now have made huge strides. You have made huge strides into this movement, and I did go somewhere where CICs were called a movement, and it does feel that way, because as I said at the beginning, you like to interact, you like to work with each other, you like to know what you're doing, and you're part of something that's really good. We've done a number of things during my tenure, including changing the legislation. And the most recent change was in October last year, 2014, where we took away the dividend cap on share companies, and by doing that removed the link to the paid-up value of those shares, which made CIC's shares much more interesting, I hope, to investors. That was the intention. And it came at the same time as social investment tax relief, which gives tax relief to investors. So there was a double effect. We are seeing more community interest companies registering as shell companies. We might have seen that anyway, but I'm hoping that part of it is a result of those changes, but we won't know straight away. It will take time for that to filter through and for us to know what difference it's made. But my view is that the CIC limited by share is an exciting opportunity. It's part of that innovative way of working. It's been a little scary, I guess, to people who don't know about running those types of companies, but actually it's more straightforward than you think, and actually it can generate income and bring investors in that you wouldn't normally get. So I would like to see there being more share companies. Ordinary companies, if you look at ordinary companies, there are more share companies than not. So we want to address that balance. So we've changed the legislation. The world has looked at us. We've got three provinces in Canada that are running community interest company models. They're doing it slightly differently. One of them is not regulated, and that really interests me because I want to see how that works. We've been looked at by Japan and Korea and China, all of who are looking at it from an employment perspective, but are interested in the model, and somebody wrote a book in China about it. It's in Chinese, so I don't know what it says, but I'm sure it's really interesting. I know Australia are interested in what we've done. I know they've looked at it in South Africa and across Africa as a whole. So we've blazed a trail and continue to blaze a trail. We're the first model of this type in the world, and I hope it will be used as an example, and I hope we will learn back where people use it. There's a new kid on the block. It's called B Corp. I quite like B Corp. If you're a CIC, you can qualify as a B Corp pretty much automatically. It's a certification process. It's coming to the UK in the autumn. I'm not promoting it, but I'm just telling you it's here, because actually it's not aimed particularly at social enterprise or you guys. It's aimed at the private sector to get them to think much more seriously about how they treat their employees, what they do environmentally, how they work in their local communities. All those things that we do because that's who we are, but that maybe private industries don't. And if we look at somebody like Unilever, who has gone down that route, who are blazing a trail in their own way with the B Corp, it's quite an interesting thing to look at, and I think it's something to be aware of. I've talked about SITR, we've had that. We've got two new initiatives that I will be leaving you with as the regulator. One is that we now have an action group as part of my advisory group, who are going to look at the promotion and improved promotion of CICs, because as a part-time worker, I've done my best, but I couldn't do it all. And we now need to set the new phase where it isn't about me necessarily promoting CICs, but it's about CICs and the sector promoting it more. So we've got some work that started there. And we've also done some work on governance and a framework for guidance on governance of CICs as a result of the changes in the legislation, which freed the companies up a bit. And we wanted to make sure that we reminded directors what they were about. So this framework of governance is going to be launched on the 10th of September at our final roadshow event in London, at Bateswells and Braithwaite, where the original idea for CICs came from their then senior partner. So watch out for that. It's going to be a little handbag pocket-sized document, so you can carry it around with you. And when you can't remember what you're supposed to do as a director of CIC, you can just get it out, you know, and have a look, and then you know. So that's two things that I'm going to be leaving you with. I'm also going to be leaving you with Kerry Wichard, who is going to be the new regulator of community interest companies. Her appointment was announced earlier this week. She works for the Intellectual Property Office in Newport in Cardiff, and my team are claiming her as the first Welsh CIC, which they're really pleased about, because my predecessor was Scottish and I'm English. So they're really pleased they've got a Welsh girl. I think she's a career girl. She has a foot in the sector in that she's a trustee on a couple of charity boards, so she knows about the sector. And I'm going to make sure she knows about CICs.
before she starts on the 7th of September, but that's her official start date. That's probably as much as I should say because I'm running out of time, but I'm here all day and I'm very happy to talk to you about CICs some more. Thank you again to all of you who have been involved in organising this, and thank you, CICs, for all your support. And thank you for your compliance, because one of the issues with B Corp in the United States is that it's not regulated and they only get 7% compliance on their reporting process. I'm very pleased to say that we get pretty close to 100%. So well done, and thank you for that, and thank you for being CICs. And just finally, our annual report has now been approved by Parliament and is available in some bags out in the other room, but is also on our website. I'm sorry about the picture on the front. They sprung it on me at the last minute. Thank you.
Thank you, Nina. I thought I'd talk a little bit about the sort of origins of the CICs and then leap forward and talk about the landscape now. Sarah's touched on the latter a little bit, so I'll try not to duplicate too much given the timing. But talking about how CICs came into being, and apologies if some of you have sort of heard this before, but I think there are some lessons and analogies that can be drawn out of that process. Anyone who in recent years has been working in the social enterprise space, for them, CICs will seem very commonplace. I had jotted down, because there's over 10,000 in existence. I'll just need to update that now, over 11,000 in existence, which is great. But back at the sort of the start of the century, that wasn't the case. You had the limited companies whose focus was increasingly on generating and maximising profit for the shareholders, and you had charities who were being very closely regulated in terms of delivering sort of public good, and there was a huge gap in between. There was industrial and provident societies who filled that gap, but in quite a niche respect, so suitable for some circumstances but not all. Besides working for Bateswells, I'm based in Bristol. I serve on the board of the Bristol Pound CIC and on the board of the Bristol Green Capital Partnership CIC, and I've been involved in creating a number of the CICs in the city, whether it's Co-Wheels or Portland Centre for Integrative Medicine or Handax, which actually came out at the university. But I work for BWB based in London and split my time between the two bases. And to a large extent, the reason I do that is because of Stephen Lloyd. And Stephen was the senior partner at Bates Wells. Fantastic. And sadly, Stephen died last year. But back at the start of the century, when we had the private the limited companies and we had the charities, it was Stephen who certainly wasn't alone in bemoaning this gap, particularly when social enterprise as a concept was already in existence. But he was somebody who actually did something about it, and. It's typical of Stephen, I guess, that with a glint in his eye, he always said that the concept of community interest companies came out of a conversation in a wine bar. Not typical that he was always in wine bars, but he was always sort of interested in trying to improve the sector, always looking for ways to do it, whether it was sort of work and out of work all merged for Stephen. And so sitting in the wine bar having this conversation, I mean, quite often, I'm sure he wasn't the first to do that, but rather than just sort of saying, okay, well, if we were trying to create something new, what would it look like? he not only had that discussion, you know, he sort of looked at, okay, well, how can we, on the one hand, create a vehicle that will keep investors, as Ted alluded to, sort of, you know, interested in, and see that it's got a commercial focus that makes them feel comfortable that it's something they might have an interest in, but also create something that potential grant funders and potential public sector bodies might have the confidence to engage with as well. So looked at things like the asset lock, and looked at things like the community benefit test, and looked at things like the dividend cap, and brought those into a form that was actually deliverable, and then took it beyond just a conversation in the wine bar and said, okay, so what do we do next? Fortunately, he had already taken the concept of sustainable development and managed to persuade the Charity Commission to accept that as a new charitable purpose. So he understood the processes that are involved in taking something from idea to actuality. He understood that a large part of it was effectively letting go of the idea to the extent that he introduced it to people in political circles and let them assume ownership of it, and was quite happy to sit in the background and just push it and make sure that it stayed on track and didn't become something that was going to become unworkable or drift away from the original mission. And he was also, he understood that with new innovations it's important sort of not to scare the horses. He was understood that the priority was actually getting community interest companies created as a vehicle onto the statute book, however modest it may be. I mean, there may be parallels with the Social Value Act possibly now, but you know, once it was on the statute book, once it existed and potentially had quite restrictive terms around it, as Sarah's alluded to, over the next 10 years there's been a process of chipping away at it and saying, well, actually, it would be a bit better if we managed to extend the cap or remove it in some respect and change things here and there, so that now, 10 years on, we're at a position where it feels that the balance between the social purpose and the commercial aspirations is stronger than ever and creating more opportunities. So I'm not going to, we get all the time sort of people coming to us who are looking to set up vehicles to create social impact and are aware of many of the terms that are out there, you know, whether it's charities, trusts, foundations, social enterprises, KICs, ELGs, BenComs, you know, it goes on and on, and now there's B Corps coming into the frame as well, launching on 17th of September, I think. So there's all of this, and there's the sessions dealing with that this afternoon. But I think what I'll just touch on is the sort of the energy that's in the broader social enterprise space, and the role of KICs right at the heart of that. Because I guess whilst not all social enterprises are KICs, then being a KIC is a really strong indication of being a social enterprise and being at the heart of the social economy. And as the KIC is evolving through things like the removal of the dividend cap and some of the initiatives that Sarah's talked about, so we've got at the moment the Financial Conduct Authority conducting consultations around BenComs and community benefit societies and co-ops, and how they need to be registered and regulated, and the Charity Commission as well looking at some of the issues around that. So it's a very, very fluid space at the moment, which potentially may or may not impact on how KICs themselves are going to be perceived more broadly. As Sarah alluded to, we've got the social investment tax relief, and we've got the changes to the dividend cap, which do potentially create lots of exciting opportunities for KICs. But at the same time, there are more challenges, particularly for the boards, around managing to preserve that balance between the social purpose and the commercial focus, which is why the governance handbook hopefully will be very useful in terms of reminding boards in particular how to again manage those potentially conflicting tensions that are emerging in some cases. I mean, it's possible, I guess, to take a view that in the broader political environment, you know, the sort of the neoliberal economic flavour of the month, the textbook isn't particularly conducive to social enterprise and what we're trying to do. But again, I think that potentially a few years of the process continues of increasing disparity of income between rich and poor, the increasing inability of some regulators in the mainstream system to manage competition between things like the big energy companies, or to deal with criminal practices by the banks, the evidence of somebody like Serco, who 1 minute looks like they're sort of all-conquering and within a year are sort of fighting for their existence. You know, increasingly there's potentially a cumulative impact of people looking for other ways of doing it. And the fact that not only is there something like a kick that exists, but it's well established, the models have been refined, and there's evidence of it working, I think is really encouraging for what the future may hold, when at the moment it might not look quite so positive. I think some of the challenges that continue for kicks, it's again sort of when you're within the space, it's very easy to assume everybody knows exactly what kicks and social enterprises are. But outside of this, it's still by no means the case. There are lots of people out there, including a lot of commissioners, who don't necessarily understand and are potentially sort of prejudiced about sort of, well, it's not a proper business, is it? Or it's not a proper not-for-profit, is it? And I don't understand it, so therefore I don't like it. So there's a continuing sort of communications piece that's quite important about being very clear about the mission, about how it interacts with the profits and how they are used, and the profit for purpose, I think, is a very nice, catchy way of dealing with that. I think the reason I told the story about Stephen and the sort of the wine bar origins of the kick is, to me, that in itself is a lovely example of social enterprise. It was he was a man who wanted to see good done, and he recognised that in order to achieve it, there was a role that money and investment had to play, and he was prepared to, he was committed enough and he was enterprising enough to had the energy and perseverance to sort of take that through over a number of years to see it happened. And I'm sure those of you who are running social enterprises will, I suspect, empathise with a lot of that. It takes a lot of energy, it takes a lot of perseverance, it takes a big commitment. But that, I think, is what we're celebrating today and what is being celebrated around the country with the Kick Roadshow. I'll leave it there.
Any questions for Sara, maybe?
Yeah, question both of you, the answer. I mean, this is around where we see kicks going, say, over the next 10 years. And part of the question is, and looking back on what B called very earlier, do you think kicks will ever look at kind of the internal value structures and processes of the company, i.e. how people work with their people, things like minimum wages, and I suppose looking at values inside companies, is that something that's been thought of? Is it possible?
I think to a certain extent by virtue of what they are, they do look at that. Although I'm not sure that environmental issues are always in terms of the people they work with and how they employ, where they employ, those sorts of things. But I think it is something that would be a good opportunity to take in terms of doing some research and really getting them to look at it. I'm hoping that the Code of Governance will help some of that. But that is for the Board of Directors, and it's not aimed at the wider CIC. Internal values are important. As I said, they can become a certified, I'm not sure that's the right way to say it, but anyway, a certified B Corp pretty automatically. It's a point system for anybody who doesn't know. They have to go through a process of demonstrating those values, all those internal values around being a company and how they operate. And they have to achieve 80 points. And kicks pretty much demonstrate most of that. So there's something to build on, and I would like to see that going further. In terms of where they're going, well, they're growing. I mean, you know, as you heard this morning, they're growing in numbers, they're growing in complexity, they're growing in type. I think there will be more public services going down that route. I can't remember what it's called now, but I heard of a joint initiative the other day between health and social services that is going to be a kick. So I think the type of CIC is changing, and all those other ones that were there at the beginning, as I said, a lot of them are still there. So my vision is that, you know, there will be CICs and they're here to stay. I think we've made our mark now. I think that, you know, once we hit 10,000 and now we've got 10 years, they're part of the social enterprise sector, but they kind of go around the edges of it as well. So they're here to stay, as far as I'm concerned, but you need to ask the next regulator about what she thinks about that.
Yeah, well, I guess it's sort of a bit analogous in a way to what Martin raised earlier, that it's possible for that there'll be kicks who have all these own values already and in this place, and you may see B Corps as a means of having a very visible way of demonstrating that. There may be some of you who don't feel they need that, they're just content to remain as a kick in the same way. Some private companies previously were fairly ethical in the way they did things, but didn't particularly have a means of showing that, and some now still are, but don't feel the need to become a kick. One, and maybe some that don't feel the need to go that way. So it's, you know, there will still be a sort of a mixed economy, if you like. We're working at the moment on refining some sort of template articles for kicks that would sort of get some of the points they need to get to the SDA to demonstrate those internal values. So that's, you know, that's being developed. I think whether it's kicks or B-books or ones that are both, it is part of a hopefully a journey towards just becoming increasingly the norm rather than sort of have some fringes and more ways than are to get business beyond just the genetic value of maximisation.
We are about to get our first PLC, CIC, very soon.
Sorry.
We're about to get our first PLC, CIC. So again, it's the next step in the CIC generation.
I think sort of over 10 years we've had the demand for 10 years and 10 years enterprises, and in that period, if you look at what's happened in the public sector, private, charitable, cooperative. There's been various kind of scandals or challenges, whether it's on the Epsom Co-op or the staff or whatever it is. We sort of haven't had that yet. Do you think over the next 10 years, actually, in a way, there's a chance, as I mean, we might kind of need that to help set the boundaries of the side, to actually test the few kind of cases and say, well, this is and this isn't, and actually that might help us, and we have to, in a way, be prepared for that.
Yes.
And I guess the focus is, you may not be able to say this, do you think that would rely on part in private sector action, press and media scrutiny, kind of almost helping regulators do their job?
Yes. I think yes to all of that. I think as CICs become more complex and bigger, there will be some misdemeanours. We have a process in place, we have a very robust complaints procedure, and we are prepared for it, and we've come pretty close to taking some very serious action. We do take some action already. What we don't do, which is what the Charity Commission do, is to publish reports on the complaints that we receive and how we deal with them. We do talk about them anonymously in the annual report, and we're looking at putting something on the website, but at the moment, and this I'm sure will change, but at the moment we don't want to jeopardise the reputation of the CIC by announcing that there's been a problem or that there is a problem when actually there may not be, and we resolve it. And we do work very hard with CICs to resolve their issues. So we have dealt with, I think, something like 80 complaints this year for CICs.
Alice Gunning here. in my mind with times and remaining questions. So I'm going to say that the new
press voluntary regulatory body is the CIC, and so is Ipsos. So I don't know if that's interesting or not, but I was quite proud of it.
I was interested in your comments about promotion for two things really. One was for the amount of professional people I come across who don't know anything about CICs, even accountants. Really. Yeah. So that's interesting. Promotion. But equally, promoting within the CIC community, I'd be very interested in, and I don't know whether you see it as your role or through the association that we've got, which seems a little sleepy to me, but we could do an awful lot more promoting our own operations and services within the community. And I'd be interested in.
I had high hopes for the CIC Association because that's exactly the role that I had hoped that it was going to take on as being the main representative body for CICs. And they haven't been able to do that, and a lot of that has been around funding and some other things as well. There is a need for some means of getting that information out there and sharing it. As the regulator, I do as much as I can, but actually now the regulator's role is becoming much more regulatory in dealing with complaints and dealing with issues and dealing with... we had 6,000 annual reports in this year. We looked at every one of them, and then we do a round of sample and detail. So the officer's time and my time are taken up much more in those sorts of things, which is why we're working with my advisory group on setting up some other ways of promoting CICs, and that includes some workshops and some stuff around the country. But there is an awful lot more. You're right, there are a lot of people who don't know, and still to this day, as I said when I first started, you can go out on the street and ask somebody what a charity is, and they'll probably be able to give you an answer. If you ask them what a CIC is, they may not. I think there's a huge role for people like Julie and her organisation who have, how many patients? Thousands and thousands of patients.
Tens
of thousands. To a captive audience to whom we could get the message out. That's general public, to whom we could say CICs. And I think there is an opportunity there, but there's lots to do, I agree.
Yes, just touching on your question. For those who might not be aware, we are actually videoing the session, and I'm doing my best to record anything happening at the podium and that can be shared, because sharing the conversations about CICs and getting people involved, you've got 11,000 on your books, and you've got 80 in the room. So there's more to share. So that's something that hopefully we can contribute to.
I've so many questions in my head. Holding myself back. Thanks very much, David and Sarah. Our next speaker is Carl from Social Enterprise. Carl Benizer from Social Enterprise Works. You've got a PowerPoint presentation, so I'm just going to try and make this work and also turn
off the lights because I can't dim them. Let's see how that works out.
Yeah,
a little bit. Okay. Bear with me. Oh God. I think it is turning off the lights, isn't it?
Because you can't see anything, I thought.
Sorry about that. Is that all right now?
Is that clicker?
I think so, yeah. Otherwise you need to use that. You know how to.
Okay, well, good afternoon, everybody. My name's Carl Bellazer. I'm a director of Social Enterprise Works. For those who aren't familiar, despite getting name checked several times, including by the Mayor and the Mayor, which is lovely, we're a 22-year-old development agency supporting social enterprises and community businesses start up, sustain, and thrive. I thought I'd take a slightly different approach to my talk with you here this afternoon, and it's wonderful to be on such an esteemed panel and in a room with such passionate peers. But I'm going to ask you all to do something for me, if you'd be so kind, which is I want you all to close your eyes for a moment, and I want you all to close your eyes, and I'd like you for just for a moment to forget everything you know about social enterprise or community interest companies. Now, to many of you, that might be easier than others, I appreciate. But for just for a moment, just temporarily erase all your current knowledge about social enterprise and community interest companies. Now, if you open your eyes again, I'm going to ask you to put yourself in the shoes of one of three characters. A young college leaver. A full-time mother. Or an elderly person approaching retirement. Now, every one of these individuals, characters, I shan't say it's my kid brother, my wife, my grandma, but we'll come back to that later. But essentially, every one of these individuals on the screen have an idea to make a difference in their community. It might be an app to help students get work experience. It might be a knitting club. It might be a pop-up play space. Whatever it might be, these three characters each have an idea to make a difference. However, as Sara was just alluding to, where to start? Appreciating you know absolutely nothing about social enterprise, nothing about community interest companies. Where do you go? Where do you start? When you start doing a little bit of digging, you very quickly realise there's a whole plethora of different models, and you have to pick one. Now, very quickly you realise that charity probably sounds a bit too complicated for me. I'm not all about the money, so I probably want to get involved with this social enterprise thingy in the middle here. So you've got to try and navigate your way through a quite a complex landscape to pick one model that'd be best suited for you. When you do that, you do a bit more digging, and you find out that there's at least seven different legal models underpinning this idea. Which one is best? Which one is right for me? At this point, I'll be totally honest with you, many people lose their way. Just navigating this landscape at such an early stage is found so complex for so many people that they just remain within the informal economy. It's very commonplace. For those who do wish to pursue past the informal economy and want to dig a bit deeper, if you Google Social Enterprise Bristol, chances are you'll come across ourselves, Social Enterprise Works. Which is why our telephone, that's our phone from the office by the way, rings daily with all sorts of weird, wonderful inquiries from members of the general public. And no word of a lie, I had a call just in the past few weeks. Before they had the chance to introduce themselves or even say hello, they fired straight into a question. Should I be a CIC or should I be a limited company, she says. Which just sort of goes to highlight, really, despite all of the knowledge and expertise in this room, as we were just touching on upon the panel, there is definitely a distinct lack of awareness and general understanding about social enterprise and community interest companies from members of the general public. This was sort of amplified recently when I tweeted out a question in advance of this presentation today to try and gather some responses from people out there to feel what are the challenges they face when they start up and grow. So Sarah's going to hate me for this. But the first tweet I received just a couple of days ago absolutely amplifies and echoes the point just made. People currently going through the process finding it very confusing, which, like we've just sort of discussed, is certainly something which needs some further attention. Another barrier about growing and scaling their business and funding, being development funding, being a key obstacle essentially for them to grow and scale their venture, which isn't terribly surprising really when you look at some of the top barriers for social enterprises, both to start up and to scale up. Yes, the public awareness comes in the top five for startups, but funding, lack of access to funding and finance is by far, I believe, 40% of all social enterprises there or thereabouts struggle, and it's the biggest factor by far preventing social enterprise community interest companies starting and scaling up. However, despite all of these challenges, the most recent mapping data, which admittedly is a couple of years out of date now, delivered by ourselves and supported by the local enterprise partnership, goes to show that there was around 600 social enterprises in the west of England, as you can see from the slide, covering a wide variety of different industries and sectors. Now, at the time, there was 102 CICs out of the 600. I'm happy to hear that's now absolutely exploded within 2 years to 250, which is quite a commendable achievement in its own right. but from the 600 social enterprises taken a couple of years ago, annually generate £380 million worth of turnover just in our region, just in this sector, and employ about 10,000 people. So collectively, we're having an incredible impact, despite all the barriers and despite all the challenges. I wanted to sort of bring this to life, really, with a couple of my favourite CICs that we supported. Sonongi is going to have to give us away, sorry to put you on the spot, from Paper Arts, which is a fantastic CIC, which I love the fact of starting out informally, prove the concept through a pop-up shop, and now have their own premises in town. Working with long-term unemployed people to combine their creativity and their enterprising skills to sell and make products that they love and to make a sustainable income from doing so. And it's great to see them going from strength to strength. Another local success story many of you are probably familiar with is the Seven Project. And again, a wonderful success story starting out in 2010 with a fellow with a passion with no experience, no skills of doing any kind of horticulture whatsoever. A bit of disused land, a few thousand pounds, and all these, I'd say 5 years later, now runs a very effective and dynamic urban farm, providing opportunity and training for those in drug and alcohol dependency to gain horticultural skills, and now providing and serving over 80 partners, including cafes and restaurants across the city. So again, there's some fantastic stories for us to be sharing. I was thinking about sharing some challenges, just being real with you, but also some opportunities. When it comes to opportunities, personally, I think opportunities are everywhere, if you know where to look. And I think part of the challenge that we find is some of the knowledge and expertise in this room isn't widely accessible, available, easy to find and stumble across. So I put together a short list, by far not an exhaustive list, but some current opportunities that I thought I'd share with you all the same, many of which you'll be familiar with, hopefully some of which you won't. We talked about the lack of understanding, but I think generally speaking, there's raising levels of interest from all directions, from universities looking to retain their graduates, keeping them in the city, to the delivery of public services. And across the board, there's interest and opportunity for collaboration, private, public sector, all seeing the value that social enterprises can bring in delivering sustainable change. The second point around the Social Value Act, which hopefully some of you, or most of you, should be familiar with, I put in brackets the implementation. As it currently it stands, local authorities have to consider the social value that their procurement creates rather than actually do something about it. Luckily here in Bristol there have been some of the more progressive local authorities that have to give credit where it's due. But for those who aren't familiar, by all accounts, with regards to procurement, local authorities are scoring up to 10% of their contract based on social value. Now, from my understanding, contracts can be won and lost on as little as 5%. So actually, it goes to show there is a real opportunity around the Social Value Act for social enterprises to thrive and grow. The next is many would regard as an opportunity. David Cameron's been around the world pimping out social investment is great and telling everybody how amazing it is. Personally, I see a lot of social enterprises who either, for a start, there's a ridiculous amount of debt capital available to social enterprises. Challenges, many of them either don't want it or they're not ready for it. And irrespective of both of those responses, there is a big opportunity at the moment for social enterprises to get yourselves investment ready. Whether you want to take on debt or not, there are programs, funding, support available for you to become more resilient, to increase your capacity, to develop your skills and capabilities in organization, to ensure you stay through the hard times. Social innovation, bit of a buzzy word, social inclusion, it's particularly relevant at the moment with knock and effect down from Europe. The EU Commission and the EU Structural Investment Funds, for those who aren't familiar, have highlighted social innovation and inclusion as to be a key priority theme. There's currently a live opportunity the civil society is working to at the moment to look to reduce barriers to employment and have a consortium of civil society, voluntary community and social organisations in partnership delivered through the local enterprise partnership to make a real difference here in the west of England. Community investment levy, a show of hands, anybody heard of the community investment levy? A few, excellent. Well, again, it's a relatively new thing, whereby essentially it's a new tax on new development. which can be used for infrastructure projects to help local communities develop. And I believe in Bristol the priorities are very much being led by neighbourhood partnerships. You have some discretionary funds for any new developer in that area to engage and support community growth and development. So again, some things to explore. Corporate supporters, it feels like every corporation from Starbucks to Santander wants to go beyond CSR and really starting to change their approaches to how they support social good. So it sort of feels moving forward there's an absolutely increased level of interest from the corporate world to want to really engage social enterprises and be that an enabling role to help make a bigger impact both locally, nationally and internationally. And lastly, I'm sure this isn't an exhaustive list, I'm sure there's many, many others that we can discuss later today, but just to sort of set the frame a little bit, I really feel and sense that there is a genuine desire to collaborate, to work together, to be greater than the sum of our parts. It sort of feels ultimately that we're all heading in the same direction, trying to achieve our social purpose and our social mission. So I really feel that one of the biggest opportunities at the moment is for us all to have greater impact collectively. And on that note, looking to the future, I think there's a number of really interesting examples for us to do that. One of which was the Social Economy Alliance, which was a 450 organisations spanning charity, social enterprise and the private sector, all coming together to have a unified voice to lobby the government to enable a more social economy. Out of our silos, we all have that common theme. Another local example would be the Bristol and Bath Social Enterprise Network. Hopefully most of you will be familiar, put on some fantastic events to meet like-minded individuals, learn, share, meet, connect. For those who aren't familiar, although again very kindly got a little shout from the Dean of the school here, we've been spending this past year on an experimental project, working with a wide variety of stakeholders, including the University of the West of England. And I have to ask you to give us a wave. Fantastic. Obviously, we've got a University of Bristol, but also the School for Social Entrepreneurs and Dirk. And a wide variety of other stakeholders to look at how we provide incubation acceleration, but also match the needs of researchers to help them increase the impact of social entrepreneurs in the community, in local neighbourhoods. And lastly, my final point. Again, for those who aren't aware, I think we have still yet to live up to our potential as possibly the greatest social enterprise city in the world ever. And on that note, as I'm in the law school, I rest my case.
Thanks, Kai. Our next speaker is Paula Woodland from the British Council, and I'm just going to put this up. Oh, great.
Hi, so the good news is I'm the last speaker before lunch. The bad news is that I also have a PowerPoint, so apologies about
that.
I'll
be quick.
I'll try and keep it fairly quick. I'm Paula Woodman and I advise the Global Social Enterprise Programme at the British Council. The British Council, you may not know so well, we're the UK's cultural relations organisation. So we've been around for about 80 years and we have offices in 110 countries globally. And the idea is that we can create a basis of friendly knowledge and understanding between people. And we believe that that will help the world to be a better, more collaborative and positive place for Britain, but also for the rest of the world. And I think the reason I'm here, obviously we've heard from the regulators and the official speakers, we've heard from the Bristol context, and hopefully I can add a bit in terms of this being a global movement and something which the British Council is hugely excited about. The level of interest globally is phenomenal, both on the ground, from people, as we've heard, wanting to do business differently, so thousands of social entrepreneurs in China. Myanmar, Burma, is opening up its doors to trade. It's being prescribed how to grow by people like the IMF and the World Bank. It's being prescribed old medicine. And they have recognised they don't want the old medicine. They want to skip to a modern concept of a modern capitalist economy. They want investment, but they want investment that's going to do the best thing for their population. They do not want garment factories collapsing on top of thousands of people. They want businesses that are going to really create a sustainable society for Myanmar. So some of these conversations we're very privileged to be involved in. And I think the KIC has a huge part to play in this. I mean, we're the British Council, so we're not Ashoka, we're not Skoll. We are here to celebrate what the UK has done for this global movement. And the KIC structure, not only have we heard how many thousands of KICs there are, all creating incredible impact in their own areas, but also I think the KIC structure itself was a really important marker that it is possible to have a company that is blending financial, economic, social, environmental concerns into its DNA. And that marker is something that other countries are really interested in, and both policymakers and social entrepreneurs on the ground are trying to fulfill that same vision. So very exciting. I think there's another reason why I'm here today, and I thought I'd share with you a little joke. I started my own journey into social enterprise in the late 90s, and Bristol was always very much a one to watch. I was working in London at the time, and actually it's part of the reason why I moved to Bristol, the thriving social enterprise scene that we have in Bristol. And so for some of my colleagues at the British Council, there's a bit of a joke in terms of how strong I try and advocate for Bristol as well. So hopefully this will work. That's confidential for within this room.
It's on video.
So why we do social enterprise, it sits within our society area of work, within the Education Society Department. You can see there's four themes there, and social enterprise 2 years ago became one of those four themes. We actually have a social enterprise programme that's been running since 2008-09 across about 9 countries in East Asia. So we have a longer track record, which is really useful. But what happened 2 years ago is that the board of the British Council decided, yes, this is an important theme for us globally. So that's a huge opportunity for us. And as I say, the reason the British Council is working in social enterprise is largely because of the UK success story. And in terms of policymakers and people on the ground, it's such a compelling story. How do you grow an economy while being more inclusive? And the statistics from the UK social enterprise movement shows it's growing faster, it's more innovative, more new products and services being developed, but it's also got more women leading those enterprises. It's got more ethnic minorities leading those enterprises. It shows more care for the environment. So this is a hugely compelling story. And in terms of the scope and scale of what it's actually achieving, this is not niche. This is not something to be overlooked. So that's really important to why the British Council is active in this area. And we very much collaborate with the UK. So we work very much with Social Enterprise UK, also our colleagues in Scotland who have a fantastic ecosystem as well, and a range of partners, including in the higher education space as well, which I'll come to. And the themes that we work in broadly, some of which I've touched upon, policy and government engagement. So we're quite uniquely placed. The British Council has globally quite a trusted brand in lots of regions and countries where over times of conflict or change, the British Council has been quite a steady and seen as a very positive force within those societies. So we engage a huge number of policymakers who want to think about this, who want to learn from good practice. And I'm pleased to say 29% of the policymakers we've engaged with, we've found have gone on to actually change policies in their country, which goes to show, I think, the scale of change. It's not all down to the British Council, obviously, but the scale of interest and change from policymakers. Capacity building, so we've trained 9,000 social entrepreneurs globally and very much drawing on UK expertise. So a lot of countries, very envious of the amount of expertise in agencies such as social enterprise works, how to really support social enterprises. We work in education systems, so that's particularly recognising the British Council has already huge programmes in higher education internationally, schools, vocational education, and how can we use that brand and that credibility? I mean, they run mobility programmes for professors, mobility programmes for students, research programmes, international conferences for higher education. We're using all of that to support social enterprise as well. So we've been at the Global Higher Education Conference 2 years in a row now with dedicated sessions on social enterprise. We're doing some new research which is looking at hotspot countries where higher education is supporting social enterprise. So really trying to uncover those different techniques and styles and success stories. We'll also be launching a free pack for schools, which we have a massive programme with DFID, Connecting Classrooms, so really trying to feed in and help teachers who might want to run a project for their students around social enterprise. Again, we're working with UK expertise, so that's with Rio, you might know from the Southwest, and the Scottish Social Enterprise Academy, who've both been doing schools programmes for many years. And the third area, international development, which I'll probably come to more later, but we're very interested in understanding and making a very clear link between social enterprise and some of the big international development questions which are particularly being asked at the moment. A real life example, so this is Pelangi Nusantara from Indonesia. When they recruited me, they didn't check on my ability to name different names and vehicles, obviously. But she already was running a micro enterprise, and she realised an opportunity to grow her enterprise at the same time as realising some really significant problems for women in her very marginalised small community in Indonesia. So she brought those two things together with the British Council's support, with the idea of social enterprise. It set her free. So she's now created this incredible social enterprise, offering women their own ability to generate money, the independence that comes with that, and the increased status that comes with that. And these are some of the communication channels that the British Council has on social enterprise. Particularly, we've just launched a new video, Social Enterprise, An Idea Whose Time Has Come. And in that video, we've pulled together loads of the big global voices. It's a very inspiring sort of talking heads video. So you have somebody from India, from Pakistan, from America, from the UK, all of them talking about this new sort of business that we see globally. And I thought I'd leave you with this, which, thank you, Ted. I think this is from from Ted's Facebook earlier this week. And I thought it really summed up, actually, the global question, coming back to this theme of international development, the global question that we're facing at the moment. So you may know the Sustainable Development Goals are being agreed, probably, in September. Inclusion, economic inequality is absolutely part of the conversation there. And in terms of really positive ideas of how to create more equal societies, there's not much on the table, it seems. And we're really looking at whether social enterprise can play a role there and how we evidence that and voice that potential. So it's a piece of work we're engaged in at the moment. But I think this sums it up, and in fact, maybe it would save us reading. I'm sure you've heard of Thomas Piketty's amazing piece. I felt this summed it up quite succinctly. So that's it from me. Those are our contact points, including a newsletter, and we'd really like to stay in touch with everybody in the UK on social enterprise. So do feel free to contact us.